All right, that was 24K Golden, and we're back. Hello.
Hello.
I've been wanting to talk to you. Well, there's two things I want to say right up front. Number one, I can't wait till I'm in a conversation with somebody and they tell me, well, Nicole, there's two sides to every story, because I can't wait to drop the no.
Well, actually,
there's three sides. Dude, what a catchy song. And the other thing, I've been rooting for you from the get-go because I have a special place in my heart for Scorpios.
Oh, are you a Scorpio too?
My birthday is November 13th.
Whoa, have the same birthday?
We have the same birthday.
Oh, I feel you on another level now. We're locked in.
No. So now we're like birthday twins. And being a Scorpio is a special thing to begin with. November 13th Scorpios, now you're talking.
My Scorpio sister.
I recognize a lot of the same energy that I have in you. Let me go back to the beginning. First, I want to ask you, before you went down the music path, at USC Business School, and I know you were, you had dabbled in commercials and stuff when you were young, but you're at USC Business School. So to go from there, to take the leap of faith from there to go to hell with it, I'm just gonna focus on music. When did that happen? Was there a specific thing that happened that made you go, all right, I'm out?
So as soon as I like got accepted to college and knew that I wanted to do music, it was always in the back of my mind, like, I'm probably going to have to drop out. It'll probably be sophomore year, junior year. You know, it might take a couple years to get to that point, but I know it's unlikely that I'm going to finish college. So when I got that call from Barry Weiss, like 4 months in, saying, I want to sign you, I was like, well, damn, this happened a lot faster than I thought. But even after I got signed, I still went to school for a month just trying to remain normal as long as possible, until one day I was like, I can't take this shit anymore. I got to go. And I just remember like walking out of class, like telling my teacher, like, I got to go. By the way, I won't be here next week. And then just never went to any class again.
Why did you feel it important to go to school in the first place? And I'm not knocking school. I started college and got an opportunity to follow my dreams into the music business. And I was like, I gotta go. So I followed my dreams like you did. Must be a Scorpio thing. But why did you feel it was important to enroll at all when you knew, like, deep inside there was another calling?
Because school was a step on that path towards my dream, you know? Okay. Me being who I am, it's like, of course I believe in myself, but worst case scenario, it's not bad to leave a place with a degree from one of the top business schools of all time. I got a full scholarship, so I got to live there for free. I got to eat there for free. And I was like, I get to be in LA, the best city to do what I want to do, music. Exactly. All I got to do is go to a couple of classes. No problem. So it was more like I saw it as being part of my journey rather than being an obstacle in the way of my journey.
All right, cool. So now let me rewind to just a bit before this coronavirus shit show that happened. I work in the alternative format. And so I'm used to playing bands like Coldplay and the Foo Fighters and the Chili Peppers and the White Stripes, you know, right?
Yeah.
Then all of a sudden, right before pandemic, out of nowhere comes this kid, 24kGoldn, and we start playing City of Angels. Now the whole world around me is changing, right? Because this coronavirus is happening and there's a certain energy in the air, like there's a shift. And in between the Foo Fighters and Coldplay, I'm dropping 24kGoldn. So did you have any, could you make sense of that? Did you understand what a big deal it was to kind of get dropped into that world?
At the time, no. But a bit after, I'm like, oh, I was the first artist really of this new generation to be accepted and to get put into the mix by alternative stations and rock stations. Like, that hadn't really been done before. So I began to realize, like, oh, we're breaking ground. We're changing the game right now, because I never, for one, really cared about genre. I just like good music. So it was like, oh, now the radio stations are kind of like getting on that same wave, and the whole world is kind of getting on the same wave. Like, we're in 2021. A lot of the stuff they were playing was from 10, 20 years ago. Like, we got to update it sometimes. So I was just like, cool, I'm glad that I could be part of the movement that's shifting culture into this new world.
Not only part of it, you were right there at the forefront, leading the charge, my friend, leading the charge, which was really, really cool. So then pandemic happens, right? You're starting to taste like you know, success on some level. But then lockdown happens. Tell me where you were when things started to shut down. Were you feeling like, oh no, please not now? Or were you so focused on your game that lockdown didn't have anything to do with your trajectory?
I mean, I was just, I didn't think it was going to be a year long thing. I was like, all right, it'll be a month or whatever. And then we'll all be back to good. So I was like, all right, this isn't temporary. Like, I can't get shaken by this too much. Let me just focus on the things that are in my control, because I can't go on tour. I can't do all these radio interviews and promo like I like to. So what can I do? I can make more music, and I can, you know, do social media and promote my music through social media, which before I was a signed artist, you know, before I had opportunities to talk to people like you, that's all I was doing, just making music, promoting it through social media. So it was kind of like a reset and a back to basics for me, but that's where I flourished the most. And I think we've seen that throughout the course of the pandemic.
So how do you make sense of the fact that while lockdown is happening in the world as we knew it, has completely crumbled and is changing, Mood comes out and it's pretty much the biggest song on the planet. So were you like, all right, man, I'm making all the right moves. Do you stay focused, or did you allow yourself to kind of just sink into the enjoyment of it? Like, tell me where you were at with that.
It was a whirlwind of emotions. You know, it was joy and excitement because, like you said, it was the biggest song in the world for weeks and weeks and weeks. And I'm like,
on the planet. On the planet.
I couldn't believe it, because I feel like normally when that happens, you're so busy. Now you're doing festivals and tours and clubs and all this, but none of that was happening for me. I was just chilling in my crib and doing Zooms every day. So I'm like, all right, you know, I'll go outside and no one's really there. So it's not like I'm getting recognized or anything. I'm like, is this even real? Like, are people even listening to this song? But at the same time, it was like I said, like such a blessing, and just to like be able to celebrate with my friends. And I think it's kind of a good thing that that huge leap from, you know, City of Angels and Valentino, that success to Mood global superstar success was during the pandemic. Cause I don't know if I'd be able to handle all that. Like, my whole lifestyle transforming so dramatically in a matter of weeks, you know, the pandemic kind of let me ease into it and like smooth out all the bumps before once the world opens up and I got to do everything.
A lot of artists also, when they reach that level of success, they buy into the hype and they get a little crazy, and sometimes they get a little irresponsible and they start having too much fun. And I feel like the pandemic allowed you to hone it in a little bit so that you could process it.
Yeah. Now, it was like training wheels.
I follow you on social media, and you're always on Instagram Live, and it's so engaging. I've watched you eat pasta. I've watched you talk about shoes. I've watched you drop, you suggested to make an El Dorado belt buckle as merch. That was brilliant. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Did you ever do it?
I mean, I made a couple custom ones for myself, you know, a little exclusive, but once I have my own clothing line, I'm sure you can expect that and many other great trinkets.
Gotcha. And then another thing you did to connect with fans is you played Connect Four with fans. Tell me why you think it's important to stay connected to the fans, specifically during a time like this. What is it that they have meant to you throughout this pandemic and through the, you know, like this, just the, your album being born?
I've known this from the beginning. Nothing really matters in the music industry except the relationship between you and your fans, because those are the people that put you on their shoulders and championship you to get to have these kind of conversations and to get the covers of magazines and going on SNL and stuff like that. Like, all that other stuff is based on your fans. So at the end of the day, like, I'm incredibly appreciative of support from everywhere else, but the fans are the ones that drive it all. And especially during a pandemic, people are locked in their houses, sad. They have nothing to do. They can't see their friends. They're just looking for the light and a beacon of hope and joy to take them out of whatever reality that they're dissatisfied with right now. So if I can do that for 20,000 people by playing Connect Four on Instagram Live for half an hour, that means so much more to the world than it does than the time that it takes away from me. So I'm always willing and happy to do stuff like that.
You're an old soul, number one. Number two, you're super articulate, and your energy and your excitement for everything that you're doing is so infectious, and it comes through. When you dropped El Dorado and you posted the picture of your billboard in Times Square, I don't even know you, dude, and I almost cried for you because you can tell that it's not wasted on you, that you're feeling all of the things that you should be feeling along with your fans. You don't take any of it for granted, and that comes through. How would you say that you're an old soul, or have you always been able to kind of, you know, process what's right?
People have been telling me I was an old soul since I was like 5 years old. And I'm like, all right, I guess. But I think as I've grown up, I've definitely kind of like understood what that meant more. Just, you know, not taking things for granted, not being jaded, like knowing that, yo, this isn't forever. It's not every day that you get the number one song on the planet, like you said, and that I got a real shot right here to change my life, to change my family's lives, to change countless lives of people across the planet that you know, haven't had somebody to do that for them before. And it's like every day I'm replying to my fans' DMs or hopping in the Discord or doing the streams and stuff like that. And it's just like, yo, this is a opportunity that nobody from my city has ever gotten before. Nobody from my family has ever gotten before. Nobody I know has ever gotten before has done it this way. So, hey, if you're not appreciative of things, they'll go away. And I'm definitely appreciative of all of this.
I was watching, my favorite song on El Dorado is Love or Lust. It's just such a damn good, it's such a jam, it's ridiculous. And Miley Cyrus posted a picture of herself in the car singing that song. And it tripped me out for you. What trips you out? Like, what makes you go, oh my God, pinch me. Is this really happening?
It's like insane. Like Miley Cyrus, somebody that I watched on TV, you know, with my sister as a kid, is now a friend, and she's bumping my music. Like I went to New York in January, and I ended up running to ASAP Rocky at the studio, and we freestyled back and forth for like 20 minutes. Like somebody that I've been listening to for years. My Instagram name used to be ASVPGoldn back in middle school. Like all these things that young Golden would have lost his mind over are now my reality. And it's just, it's beautiful because I work for this.
Yeah, you did. I've got to say before I let you go, I love the way you love your mom. Since I think the first time when we started playing City of Angels that I was trying to get to know who you were and I Googled you, I think an interview came up. You were interviewing your mom or something like that, but your mom seems to pop up a lot and you seem to have a lot of love for her. And I think that's a beautiful thing. Was she a big part of your support system and the reason that you're so confident and focused?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a mama's boy for sure, but my whole family in general, like my dad is an incredible system of support. You know, if it's 1 a.m. and I'm going through it, I'm calling my dad like, yo, I can't take this shit no more. And he'll, you know, always know the exact right thing to say. My mom is always there with unconditional love and support. And I definitely credit that as the foundation of me, because they just gave me such a solid foundation to build off of. It's the sky is the limit.
What are your intentions for the future? Give me at least one thing, whether it's big or small, that you want to do. You already dropped one earlier by saying clothing line. So we got that out of the way. So I know that's coming, but give me one more thing that you want.
I want to perform in front of 100,000 people.
Yes. Do you know where, like if you could pick your first venue, would it be hometown venue?
I don't know if the hometown venue is big enough to hold 100,000 people, but where does it matter? I just want to look out over the crowd and sing my fucking heart out and get that energy reciprocated and look into the eyes of the people that have been listening to my music for the past year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, whatever it is, and just hear them sing those words back and share that moment, because performing is the best part of this entire job. You know, that just seeing the having those moments and feeling the energy from the crowd and having them feel your energy. Nothing else in the world compares to that.
No, and even as a concert goer, nothing compares to the energy in that room. Have you had thousands and thousands of people sing your song back yet?
So yeah, it was, I think 2019, maybe I did a Bay Area Rolling Loud. My first Rolling Loud Bay Area as a performer instead of a fan, like I was the year before. And I remember just peeking out from backstage and seeing like 5,000 people in the crowd. And when I went out there and did Valentino, it was like the mosh pits were crazy. There was like four different mosh pits happening, everybody jumping in and screaming out the words. And I was just like, oh yeah, this is what I was put on this earth to do.
Is it? Well, my friend, you're going to be huge, 24kGoldn, and I can't wait to watch you just like grow and grow. And I hope to be in the audience. I hope you play the Forum here in LA. Like, that's where I want to see you. I want to see you at the Forum. I think you're doing everything right. The way you connect with fans is genuine. Your excitement for what you're doing comes through, your authenticity. And I mean, you were born on November 13th. Like, we're, you know.
It's only right. It's only right. Know?
But I'm a big fan and I'm going to root for you. Every step of the way. So thank you for doing this for us. I really appreciate you. This was a highlight of my week for sure.
All right. Of course. Thank you, Nicole. I appreciate you too.